Good morning, Asbury First. We're thrilled to have you all here this morning, and we are going to kick off our annual tent service with a wonderful hymn sing. If you would all please join me in hymn number 657. We're going to start with number 657, and then I will take requests. The only request I will not honor is please stop. The choir will lead us, and I'd like the congregation to be the response. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Together. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Very nice. So we will have our wonderful hymn sing, and if you have a hymn that you would like to hear, a favorite, please raise your hand. I will call on you, and I will try to get around the tent as best as I can. I see one in the very, very back. 361. Yes, thank you. Call out hymn numbers, and we will most likely sing one verse so we can get to as many hymns as possible this morning. Number 361, Rock of Ages, Cleft for Me. One verse. We'll do the first verse.
Rock of ages, cleft for me, let my hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flowed be of sin the double cure, save from wrath and make me pure.
707.
We're singing that during the service. 707 during the service. Thank you. 369. Blessed Assurance. Again, one verse. Let's do the first verse.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
Number 68. We'll do two verses. Verse 1 and verse 5, please. Verses 1 and 5.
Creation cried, Hallelujah.
405. Bingo. We'll do both verses. Both verses. C key first, number 405.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you.
Verse one. Verse 1. Time for one more. 77. I think I know what that one is. How great thou art. Verse 1. Oh. Amen.
Please stand as you are able for the call to worship. There is one body, one spirit, one Lord of all. We are one body in Christ, bound together in holy love. There is one hope, one faith, one Father of all.
We are one family of God, blessed with gifts of one Spirit.
There is one baptism, one true home, one mother of all.
We are one people, nourished by God, with the food of eternal life.
Such a joy to be together in a different place, but with the same spirit. Friends, what a gift it is to be here. We greet you, whether you're here outside in the tent, whether you're listening on the radio, or whether, hopefully, you're watching on the live stream. Friends, what a time it is for those who are looking for a seat. Just like when we're inside, there is plenty up front. So come on down. Let us greet one another with signs of peace. The peace of Christ be with you.
please join me in our prayer of confession. Have mercy on us, great God of compassion, for our thoughts often dwell where they should not. Forgive us when we forsake your unity and concord in favor of division and mistrust. Heal us when we lock our doors, ignoring the needs of our neighbors. Put your truth deep inside us and give us a hunger for your ways, that we may grow into Christ, who is the fullness of your love. Amen. Hear the good news. In Christ, we are knit together into one family, a family of faith, hope, and love. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen.
Scripture reading is from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 32, verses 6 through 15. Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came to me. Hanamiel, son of your uncle Shalom, is going to come to you and say, 'Buy my field that is at Anathoth, for the right of redemption by purchase is yours.' Then my cousin Hanamiel came to me in the court of the guard in accordance with the word of the Lord and said to me, 'Buy my field that is at Anathoth in the land of Benjamin, for the right of possession and redemption is yours. Buy it for yourself.' Then I knew that this was the word of the Lord. And I bought the field at Anathoth from my cousin Hanamiel and weighed out the money to him, 17 shekels of silver. I signed the deed, sealed it, got witnesses, and weighed the money on scales. Then I took the sealed deed of purchase containing the terms and conditions and the open copy, and I gave the deed of purchase to Baruch, son of Neriah, son of Mahasiah, in the presence of my cousin Hanamiel, in the presence of the witnesses who signed the deed of purchase, and in the presence of all of the Judeans who were sitting in the court of the guard. In the presence I charged Baruch, saying, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these deeds, both this sealed deed of purchase and this open deed, and put them in an earthenware jar in order that they may last for a long time. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses and fields and vineyards shall again be bought in this land.' This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Of life are raging, stand by me,
oh stand
Throughout the gospel, we hear how Jesus explicitly welcomed the children to him, and in that same spirit, we welcome the children forward at this time. Children are always welcome to stay with us in worship, but immediately following this time with Miss Holly and Miss Paula, we have a children's enrichment time for ages 4 through 5th grade. So come on down. Hi, friends. It's so good to see you. Okay, so I have a question for you. Who likes to play games? You like to play games? Okay, tell me your favorite game. What's your favorite game to play outside? What's your favorite outside game, Sean?
Headbands.
Headbands? Yeah, I like to play that, whether I'm inside or outside. That's a very fun game. Ethan?
Ghost in the Graveyard.
Ghost in the Graveyard. Okay, 1 second. I'm going to go try and play it. Wait. Is this... hard to, okay, give me another game. I can't do that one on my own. All right, there's another game?
Kickball.
Kickball, okay, 1 second. Wait, okay, I can't play that one on my own either. There's a, okay. Yeah? Hopscotch, yes, yeah. You know what? I might be able to play that, but it's really a team. You know what? Most of these games, we have to play with someone else, right? It's not fun to play a game on your own. Sometimes you can do that, but the whole point in getting outside is to get to know your neighbors, the people who are around you. Does anybody like to play games with other people? Yeah, right? Why do you play games with other people?
To have fun.
To have fun, right, Ethan?
To make friends.
To make some new friends, to get to know the people around us. Well, sometimes when you get older, you forget that. You know, we start to think that we should just play games on our own, do the things that we're just going to do. That's why so many people are on their phone playing a game, right? Sometimes it's with other people, but you're sitting by yourself, right? But sometimes the best thing to do is to get together and play a game. Well, today we hear a story about a guy named Jeremiah who was having a really rough go of it. He was sitting in a jail cell, and he was thinking about, what do I do? Where do I go? What was the last time that I was really, really happy? And he was thinking back to this moment as a child when he had a field with his cousin, and he thought, I'm going to go buy that field. And it's really hard to get back to your childhood once you've left it, so we need to learn from you what it means to play and what it means to get together and to remind each other that we need one another. And so this week, some of you know that we're trying to invite, we're under this big tent, and this whole week we're inviting our neighbors out so that we can get to know them a little better. And on Thursday night, we're going to be playing a game with them. It's a game called Hopscotch, which you recommended, right? It's a game where you have to do this, right? You have to draw a box, right? Looks like this. No judgment, everyone, all right? Then you label it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm supposed to have 8. All right, let's say 9. All right. 8, 9. All right. 10. Okay, this is Hopscotch, right? So it's a game that we play, and you get 4 people together, and you play, and you toss something down, and you start at 1, and you have to go in, right? And then you have to be able to get, you have to skip the first one, and then you go all the way to the end. You can jump double on these here, here, right? And then you have to turn around and do the same thing back, and then you pick it up, and you try and throw it onto 2. Here's the thing. We need a bunch of people to come out and play. But we need people with some skills, and it's gonna need some practice. And so what I thought is that as you leave today, I would give you a piece of chalk, and I would ask you to do this. At some point in the next few days, find someplace silly, someplace, and draw a hopscotch board, okay? And try and get someone to play. All right, maybe it's one of your parents, maybe it's a neighborhood friend. See if you could get to play. And we're going to have some directions posted on our website along with a video pretty soon of how to do it. So if you're wondering how to do it, you could just go watch that. But I'm going to ask you to do that. Do you think you could do that?
Yeah.
And remember that games are meant to be played together, and we need to follow your example and reach out to one another every once in a while. Can we do that? All right. I'm going to give you this on the way out, but let's pray together if we can. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. All right, take a piece of chalk, draw something this week, invite a friend. Oh, sorry, Griffin. Here you go.
Here. Oh, yeah, you're right.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. When something's lost, sometimes it's best to go back to the last place we remember having it and retrace our steps. We might not find it, but by God's grace, we might learn something along the way. It's a game that a lot of people think is like baseball, but without the glitz or the gloves. It doesn't require much to play, save an old broomstick handle or a tennis ball or their equivalent. The field changes depending on whether we're in the city or in the suburbs, but stickball is basically the same wherever you play it. You don't need very much equipment. Bases are made of whatever you find around, a manhole cover, a street sign, an old box lid. And there are always at least a few special rules put into place to make sure that the integrity of the game is maintained. That is, no sliding, no stealing, no hopping the fence, and absolutely no crying. There's no crying in stickball. The games are made up of whomever happens to be in the neighborhood, and they go and go until either the street lights come on or there's no one left to play. A reminder that just like life, it's hard to play alone. Think back with me for a moment. Before we had bills to pay, before we had to worry about insurance or taxes or healthcare or grocery shopping, before we had to shave or make an online profile or worry about being a Democrat or a Republican, before we had to pluck our eyebrows or trim our nose hairs before any of the stuff of adulthood, most of us were children. Sure, some of us were better at it than others, and some of us never quite left, but almost all of us were kids. It might seem hard to remember now, given all that has happened, but it's true. And while no two childhoods are the same, we recognize that some of us had it easier than others. Some of us had homes to live in, and some of us not. Some of us had people who cared, and some of us not. Some of us had the privilege of race or class or gender, and some of us not. And yet there's something that almost all children have that adults too often lack. Hope. Childhood is about hope. And though throughout this summer we've seen too many children robbed of that hope, we know that at its best, childhood is a time that is supposed to be about hope. It's that time when we believe that anything is possible, when we assume the best about people, when we're not afraid to knock on our neighbor's door to see if they want to play. When was the last time we did that? How many of our neighbors do we even know? No, there comes a time, friends, hard to pinpoint as it's different for each of us, when we put an end to childish ways, when we stop going out to play, when we stop assuming the best about people, when we get too busy to meet our neighbors. And it's often at that moment that we leave our hope out on the playground and try to go on, convincing ourselves that we're better off on our own, that nobody really wants to play with us, that life is serious business. And too often when we leave that hope behind, we pick up a cynicism that robs us of life. But the good news, friends, is that it doesn't have to be that way. It doesn't have to be that way. Our children know it innately. We should pay attention to the children around us or the ones that are still inside us, dying to get out, because they're trying to tell us something about what it means to fully live. And if we can just get back to that moment, if we can find our way back to that childlike wonder at the world, we just might find that hope is still there, ready to be picked up. And so today, on this Tent Sunday, on this day when we come outside to play on our front lawn, at the beginning of this week when we try and get to meet some of our neighbors, we pause for a moment as children of the same God to try and recapture some of what has been lost. Fortunately for us, there are games to remind us of that as well. Maybe you know this one. There are lots of versions of this game, of course, but the most basic one begins with one person being it. That is, the person given some authority, a little power, sometimes it goes to their head, they're given a little power, and then they're asked to seek while everyone else hides. It's a pretty basic game. You don't need very much skill, just a little creativity and a whole lot of patience. There's no equipment needed. People just go out and they seek while others hide. And as the game goes on, once the person who's it finds their first person hidden, that person joins and they begin to seek the second person together and so on and so forth. And the great thing about hide and seek is that it doesn't end until everyone is found. A reminder to us that even though it's hard to admit, somewhere deep down, all of us long to be found. Jeremiah was found pretty early in his life. We have that first chapter of Jeremiah, which reminds us of God saying to Jeremiah, "Before you were formed in the womb, I knew you." The same thing is true for us. That's some good news. But we don't really know a whole lot else about Jeremiah's childhood, though we presume that, like most of us, he had one. We presume that he was a child running around, playing some games, getting into a little bit of trouble, though we don't know a whole lot about where that happened, save that it was in the land of the tribe of Benjamin, which was the northern part of the Judean countryside, the very southernmost part of the fallen Israeli kingdom. That is, he found a place in rural Judea. And now, as an adult, he was a big prophet in the big city, speaking the word of God, and sometimes it went well, and sometimes it didn't. I know the feeling. He was out sharing, and then when we join him today, things are not going particularly well. See, when he's there in Jerusalem, it's surrounded by the Babylonian Empire. That is, they've come in, they've conquered already the rest of Judea, and Jerusalem is under siege. And people are starting to naturally freak out a little bit, and Jeremiah is not helping because he's just telling the truth. That is, that the city is getting ready to fall, that the temple will be destroyed, and that the king will be taken into captivity. And naturally, the king was a little frustrated by him bumming everyone out. And so, accusing him of treason, he throws Jeremiah in jail. And it's there that we find him today, in a jail cell in Jerusalem, near a crumbling city, surrounded by a conquering army. Maybe we've been there. Not there literally, but we know the feeling, don't we? We know what it's like to be at one of those moments in life when it feels like we're totally surrounded by the stuff of life, when we're overwhelmed by something that we're facing that we don't quite know how it happened, when we aren't quite sure of our way forward. Maybe some of us are there today. And in those moments, we often find ourselves asking that age-old question, how did I get here? And it's so simple in those moments to long for a simpler time, to go back to those times when we were stress-free, when we didn't have to worry about all the stuff of life. We go back to those nights when we could just play outside, capture the flag, or ghosts in the graveyard, or Red Rover, Red Rover. Maybe we remember that one. That's the one where two lines form, and there's a chain of person on either side, and they call one out, Red Rover, Red Rover, send Steven right over, and you run over trying to break through the line, or at least break an arm. And you go through, and if you manage to break the line, you bring one of them over to your side, and if you don't, then you join their side. But either way, the game only ends when everyone's on one side. Again, a lesson for life. The game only ends when everyone finds their way to the same side. Maybe it was Jeremiah. Maybe it was Red Rover that Jeremiah was thinking about, or the ancient Near Eastern equivalent. But for some reason, as he's sitting there in that jail cell, he starts to think about the field of his cousin. That family field, maybe he used to play games out there late into the night. Maybe it was the place where he remembered a little hope, a little joy, and he hears that voice of God say, buy that field, which, to be clear, is a really ridiculous thing to do. It's already under foreign occupation. The city is about to fall. Jeremiah is going to be taken into captivity, and he decides to stop and buy a field, to spend his money, and to have all the witnesses around see that he's doing it and put it in an earthenware jar for safekeeping. He decides to risk a little hope. To be clear, he knew that Jerusalem was going to fall. He was the one telling the truth about that. Perhaps a reminder to those of us who find ourselves in a bit of a mess, that if we are ever going to get out of this quagmire we're in as a world, as a nation, as a community, it will take telling the truth. We've gotten used to lies lately. We need to tell the truth, that is, to speak the truth and trust that as Jesus Christ promised, the truth will set us free. Jeremiah had to tell the truth, but he also knew that if he was going to find his way out of this, he needed to play the long game. That is, life goes on, that there will be a time after this present disorder, that there will be a time when this isn't the way things are, and we have to look for that time, even if we're not there to see it. And so he buys a field. He risks a little hope, and he invites others to dream. The truth is, friends, this is a hard moment for our world. I can't be the only one who feels it. There is a malaise that seems to have fallen over, pitting neighbor against neighbor, family member against family member, congregant against congregant. We know what it feels like, right? And we've gotten used to it. We are surrounded, besieged, not by a conquering army, but by a political, ideological split that we can't seem to find our way across. It's like a game of Red Rover where instead of sending people across, we just keep taking a step back and wondering why the game won't ever end. Sure, we all bemoan the division and the divides that we find ourselves in, but none of us are finding the way to get past it, which means that things like this summer happen where we watch families and children separated from one another. And because we're so divided, can't find a way to make it right. It doesn't matter if we're a Republican or a Democrat. Are we Christians? Then it's time to do something different. Friends, it's time to make a change, to take a step towards one another, to overcome the division which we have allowed to fester among us. It means not being childish, but childlike. To find our way back to that hope which we left on the playground, and to not be afraid to run with it, to take a step towards one another. Our children will show us how. Children don't see those divisions, they're taught them. Children are willing to take a step out and knock on a neighbor's door to invite someone new to play. We teach them to fear. Maybe we can take a lesson from their book, from those games they play, and just take a step towards someone else, one person this week, maybe we can take a step towards. The whole point of the Christian faith is to love God and to love our neighbor as ourselves, but the truth is, we have to know our neighbor to love our neighbor. That's what this week is about. Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday night, we have something different on this lawn under the tent. We're leaving our church building and starting to get to know our neighbors. We have the ridiculous and the sublime, different music, goat yoga, escape rooms, stuff to be doing under here, but it culminates on Thursday evening with a harken back to that moment when we used to play together in the neighborhood. Hopscotch has been played for centuries in neighborhoods around the world. Maybe it's time to play it in ours. It might sound silly, given all that's going on in the world, to stop and to play a game together, but friends, we have to start somewhere. And maybe by just stopping and playing together, we might realize that there is more that unites us than divides us. Maybe it's going to look a little foolish, but you know what? It's worth the risk. The only way we can overcome the divisions of this world is by taking a step towards one another. It will mean putting down our phones, logging off our Facebook pages. It will mean letting go of the cynicism that has overwhelmed us and picking back up that hope we left on the playground. After all, when something's lost, sometimes it's best to just go back to that place where we last remember having it and then retrace our steps. We might not find it, but by God's grace, we might learn something along the way. Here's to hoping, or in this case, hopping. Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for your presence here with us today. We thank you for the reminder that whether we are inside or outside, you remain with us. We pray this morning for every individual that is connected to our worship experience. We release each of our concerns and needs to you. We surrender every worry, fear, uncertainty, and pending decision to you and ask for your help navigating through life's many trials. Gracious God, we pray that you would send helping hands in various forms to walk with us through all we face. Send shields of protection and comfort to all who are in need of it today. And help us to approach the coming week with open hearts and minds, trusting fully in you and in the promises of your word. We pray also for our world. We ask that you would provide peace where it is needed, love where hate seems to prevail, and healing where pain and brokenness reside. We pray for every decision maker and every person in power. Grant wisdom and changed hearts where needed. Grant each of us the courage to continue to pray and hope despite all that is happening around us. May our prayers provoke action, and may our actions lead to a better world for all of us. We pray also for endurance and strength for the busy week ahead. Remind us to pause and breathe when necessary. Give us peace to know that everything will work out just fine. And provide us with patience and flexibility so that the details and logistics don't overwhelm us or cause us to lose sight of our purpose. We pray for an incredible week that will impact our community in more ways than one. Let everything we do and say be about you. In your son Jesus' name we pray, amen.
If you are visiting with us this morning, we just want to take this moment to say we're really glad that you're here. Asbury First is not a perfect place, but we recognize we are more perfect with you than we are without you. And so we'd invite you to join us in our mission to love God and neighbor, to live fully, to serve all, and repeat. This is, as you've heard, a really busy time in the life of our congregation. This week alone, starting last week, is so busy. Thank you, thank you, thank you to everyone who has volunteered, whether it's been to help with Vacation Bible School or the block party on East Avenue this upcoming week, whether you did the bake sale or the parking or the storehouse sale, which continues into this afternoon, whether you've been at Park Avenue, whether you've been in the Into Silence truck, or whether you're helping with the chicken barbecue, which you might start to smell and get a little hankering for as we get nearer to the end. Don't worry, it's coming. All of this can only happen without the really, really hard work of everyone here. We are so grateful to you for all that you've done. The basement sale and the bake sale are fine-oiled machines. They know exactly where the cars need to go. It's a really exciting time. Those who have been paying attention know that this week, the stuff in the evening will be really fun. There's Tuesday night, is 60s, 70s night. Come dressed up, listen to music, try some goat yoga. There's food trucks every night. Wednesday evening, 80s, 90s night. We have an escape room on campus. And Thursday night, as you heard me say in the sermon, is our chance to try and set the world record for most number of hopscotchers at the same time, we could use your help. 650 people are needed, so please come on out, invite your friends. Throughout this week, we need lots of volunteers, so we have Allison and Tiffany who are over here at the East Block Party on East Ave table. Please, if you have some time this week, can volunteer one of those nights, we'd very much appreciate it. There is so much else going on in the life of the church. I'd invite you to take a look at your bulletin, read through it throughout the course of the week, look on our website, but talk to the people who are around you. They would be happy, I'm sure, to share what is going on. It is always a gift to be together, and God has blessed us with many gifts. This is a moment when we might give something back to God as the ushers wait on us for our morning tithes and offerings.
Everything all over.
God of grace and glory, receive these gifts in the service to our neighbors. Transform our lives into acts of your grace, that we may be bound into one community. Amen.
But not too far into the world to do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the times you can, in all the places you can, to all the people you can, so long as ever you can. Go in the name of Jesus Christ and do more good. Amen.
We will.